Okay. To begin to grasp the extent of the social experiment standing behind the visible structures of mass compulsion schooling, it isn't necessary to conjure up conspiracies of the classical variety, but only to look at child rearing from an engineering point of view, as animal training beyond the reach of the animal to fully comprehend, as when a falconer shrouds his bird to prevent it from obeying its nature, or when a horse racing association dictates that lead be attached to a fast horse's saddle to bring its performance in line with the rest of the pack. In both cases, bird and horse are less than they would have been, having been reduced to instruments of a different species design. With schooling, too, it shouldn't be difficult to understand that from certain perspectives, it might also be desirable to alter the behavior of human children negatively in the interests of some managerial goal. Whether a thing is good or bad depends on one's value system. We all understand that. How otherwise could we begin to understand the bald statement made by the famous dean of teacher education at Stanford in 1919 that the term of childhood had been deliberately extended for 4 years because important people wanted it that way? What could the dean, that's Elwood Cubberley, have meant? He didn't bother to elaborate. You seldom get to hear the problem of modern schooling framed as a conflict between the purposes of social managers and the purposes of individuals, families, and communities, because the 23 global corporations which control most of the flow of ideas and news and information worldwide seldom find it convenient to encourage such speculation, nor do academics in general, because it's a very bad way to get tenure. But nonetheless, this is the thesis that I'll be pursuing tonight, that enormous numbers of American children have been dumbed down and made morally incomplete in the interests of a complex theory of social management, one which emerged full-blown among corporate players somewhat over a century ago. School is the principal forge for handicapping mutilations. I'm using that term as you'd use it with a horse race. You handicap it by hanging lead weights on it. School is the central mechanism of its effectiveness. The central mechanism of its effectiveness lies in its ability to extend childhood far beyond natural bounds. Extending childhood was not originally the American way, just the reverse. Back in 1839, Alexis de Tocqueville, author of Democracy in America, and if you haven't read it, read it. It will be in every library in Boston and every library in the United States. Tocqueville tried to put his finger on a fantastic difference he had discerned between American young people and the European variety. In America, he said, I'm quoting now, there is, strictly speaking, no adolescence. At the close of boyhood, the man appears, and by inference, at the close of girlhood, the woman. That early responsibility, according to Tocqueville, imparted such a great vigor to our society that other nations could not compete, and he predicted it would be progressive and the gulf would enlarge between American power and the power of other nations, which of course it has. Where Europe inhibited the range of the young and rendered them incomplete by imposing an intricate class consciousness, age consciousness, gender consciousness, whatever, America was jettisoning such handicaps to productivity, and it roared into global prominence as a result of the advantage this conferred. Tocqueville's analysis at the beginning of the 21st century has the quaint ring of something like Alice in Wonderland, doesn't it? American young people are unrecognizable from Tocqueville's description. Childhood here has been artificially extended well into the 20s and beyond, American teenage boys are, if they're well-behaved, are goofy, daffy. And we all assume that this is natural, a natural stage in child development. In USA Today, I saw a story that the Little League Baseball organization had cooked up a series of workshops where parents would be taught how to behave at baseball games. A necessity, the article said, because the prevailing standard of parental behavior was so childish it had become dangerous. All this reminded me that just a few years earlier I had sublet my New York apartment to a young attorney, age 25, a graduate of Yale, who was interning for a Wall Street firm while he was awaiting certification as a lawyer. I was on my way to Spain the next day, so I deposited his check, wished him well, and was off. And on my return from Spain to the United States, I discovered that he had stopped payment on that check. I couldn't raise him by phone, so I called his father, who'd been given me as a reference, only to learn from the father that the son had found a better deal that very next day. And apparently both father and son deemed this an adequate explanation for breaching a contract. Fortunately, I knew that the young man still needed to appear before his review panel before his law license could be final. So I told the father I would show up at that hearing with a formal complaint unless the money was forthcoming toot sweet. And when Dad realized I had his boy over a barrel, he screamed into the phone at me. He was outraged. He said I should be ashamed of myself. His son was only 25, and hadn't I ever changed my mind when I was 25? So I could go on, but that's enough, I think. Could organized schooling have anything to do with these developments in childishness? And if so, why and how? To begin to answer that question, come back with me to the first year of the 20th century, where a book was being published by a well-known writer of the day, Edward Eggleston. But in this book of 1901, Eggleston had set himself the task of explaining America's unusual superiority to Europe, even though most of us derived from Europe. According to Eggleston, this hadn't happened all at once. In fact, the first generations here, he said, were much like those back in Europe, crippled by habits of dependency and hierarchy, by excessive management. But gradually, the hand of custom relaxed here, and the young began to come to consciousness in a world where anything was possible. Freed from the social systems of Europe, America's young eagerly seized opportunities to learn everything and to dare everything. At the age of 7, Eggleston said, Americans put away childish things to carry their share of the load. They begin to grow up. In Europe, on the other hand, ordinary children weren't allowed decision-making responsibilities because the economies of Europe could not tolerate the kind of mind and character which emerges from early mental independence. Individuals there had to be proletarianized into masses for the benefit of factories, factory farms, standing armies, and social class stability. Whatever the particular truth of these contentions, you see that for both de Tocqueville in 1839 and Eggleston in 1900, both were agreeing that childhood in the United States was a short-lived phenomenon, and that this was a good thing. A century later, it's still possible to find data to make us suspect that the earlier way has much still to recommend it, on a personal basis at least. Studies of very successful adults almost uniformly show that to a striking degree, such people grow up quickly, taking important responsibility at an early age. And history provides evidence that at one time, not so long ago, it was in fact the social norm in the United States. In 1859, for instance, Abe Lincoln told the Wisconsin Agricultural Association that the overwhelming majority of Americans, poor as well as rich, had independent livelihoods. They didn't work for anybody. That's the real American dream. Because these people had been reared from early childhood to be self-reliant, ambitious, and resourceful, and no ponderous social order, such as in Britain or Germany, had stood in their way. Just as an aside, the old order Amish in Pennsylvania and Wisconsin and Ohio and Indiana, in fact, raise all of their children to have independent livelihoods, and they succeed in about 99% of the instances. I'm not citing my imagination or observation, but a recent book from Johns Hopkins about the Amish. This principle of early self-reliance and adventure leading to future entrepreneurial triumph is still present with us, but it's no longer celebrated in schools. Take, for example, the case of Richard Branson, the founder of a prosperous airline and many, many other thriving businesses in various fields. One day when Branson was 7 years old, he was out with his mother on a drive miles from home when she suddenly asked him if he thought he could find his way home from there all alone. Branson said he thought he could, whereupon his mother stopped the car. "Well, get out then," she said. "Let's see if you're right," and drove off without her little boy. Is there anyone in earshot of these words who has done something similar? Not if you had an A average in school, I'm certain. Whatever your opinion of Mrs. Branson's decision, Richard himself looks back on it later in life as the foundation of his unlimited confidence in himself, which has made him a millionaire several hundred times over. Branson's curriculum aims squarely at the face of the principal myth of modern management, that most people cannot be trusted with responsibility because they are childish and incompetent. They have to be closely watched and managed. The minute Branson exited that car and set out to discover himself, he walked away from childhood.